as I take you along this journey that involves my personal story, I want you to see the transformative power of education and the urgent need for two words. And it's not artificial intelligence. It's sustainable development. But before we dive in, let me ask you, what comes to mind when you think of Jamaica? Maybe vibrant culture? Stunning beaches? Usain Bolt? Reggae music? One love. And maybe some other things you wouldn't say to my face openly. But how often do we think of Jamaica as a place filled with some of the most resilient people? And yes, I am Jamaican. Well, go on! Many Jamaicans like myself who want to achieve their ambitions not only have to overcome cycles of poverty, crime, and systematic barriers to opportunities, but also the limiting beliefs of what people with backgrounds like mine should be doing with themselves. Let me tell you, 8 of us who went to my high school in Jamaica are here at MIT as undergrads, pushing against those limiting beliefs. And this is a reminder of the importance for breaking down barriers and creating opportunities for success for all, regardless of where you're coming from. My story is just one example of the resilience and determination that lies within these communities. Growing up in Jamaica, I had a wonderful life that was far from easy. My mom is from a rural area. My dad is from the ghetto. They got married around my age and had me. And a few months after I was born, they separated. My mom took me and moved to live with her mom somewhere else in the capital, Kingston. And as long as I could remember, just making ends meet has been a struggle for my family. And we didn't even have many middle-class privileges. One simple example. My mom has never owned a car. And you also heard that there's complications with her coming to my graduation. But to go to and from work, she takes many buses like these. But I still had a wonderful childhood. I was surrounded by the vibrance, friendliness, and strength of the Jamaican people. And I could enjoy some of the most beautiful environments on the island. I had a strong sense of community and family, and I felt very loved. And one of the things that made my childhood really special is that I always had hope. And I'm understanding now how powerful having hope is, and that our hope is being threatened. So many people from marginalized communities like my home are under threat of having the little they have to live and smile be taken away from them by what so many people like me love to pursue, but struggle to do it responsibly, and that is innovation. One perspective that we don't highlight enough in STEM education is that our creations just often benefit, ultimately, the few most privileged in society at the cost of continuing the cycle of poorer nations being exploited for their abundant, cheap resources to fuel our innovations, and leaving the most vulnerable communities to deal with many of the worst of the consequences, like this climate crisis. For example, aluminum. We use this metal in almost everything, from utensils to phones to robots. Most of it comes from a rock called bauxite. In around 1950s, international companies from North America came to Jamaica to set up bauxite mining operations, the first on the island. A lot of my relatives live in the countryside where my mom grew up. And when you go there, you can find nearby these red mud lakes produced from discharge, from processing bauxite. By the way, Jamaica is now among the top 10 bauxite-producing nations. And we export bauxite in a form called alumina, which is a precursor to aluminum. And you're telling me, in this technological age, this is the best we can do with industrial discharge? We all want aluminum for our different needs, right? But how many of us are supporting innovation that can reduce the need of these operations to force people to leave their homes and deplete plus contaminate their groundwater? And these large-scale unfair treatments are happening all over the world. Another example, the Democratic Republic of Congo produces 60 to 70% of cobalt, a mineral essential for rechargeable battery technology. They're the number one producers in the world. I'm talking around 100,000 metric tons a year. And you're telling me that 75% of Congolese people live on less than $2 US dollars a day last year? A quarter of cobalt comes from artisanal miners, and these workers are barely paid anything. So when you factor in these injustices, tell me, how much does it really cost us to pursue the innovations that excite? And this is just the beginning of the entire supply chain story. One of my biggest concerns is that so many brilliant young people capable of addressing injustices like these are just being funneled into improving technologies like artificial intelligence when humanity is waiting for breakthroughs for urgent causes. And please, don't get me wrong. Artificial intelligence is useful. It's helping people and companies in mind-blowing ways. It promises a lot of wealth, progress, and efficiency. But for who? For which nations? For which communities? Well, we at least need to be more proactive in helping working-class families deal with, for instance, the economic disruptions that will come from AI taking their jobs. Because when our innovations make marginalized people's environments way less livable, and we take away their jobs, we make them feel forced to move. And in desperation, they go to the places where they know they aren't even welcomed. Their hope is being threatened. And with climate change and environmental degradation going through the roof, the well-being of all socioeconomic classes is being threatened. But thankfully, there is hope. I hope that many of us, including myself, find worth fighting for. On March 14, 2020, around the beginning of the COVID-19 pandemic, I had a moment that changed the course of my life forever. That was the day I saw my admission into MIT. And now I stand before you as a senior studying environmental engineering, about to graduate next month. And one way I can summarize my MIT journey is that I evolved. I became determined to come here for way more than a degree. I became determined to make a difference even before I graduate. My desire to help give people hope by being a doctor evolved into not just being an environmental engineer, but being a force that could fight against the root causes of oppression. To delve deeper into the underlying causes of, like, injustices related to climate change, irreversible environmental degradation, and massive pollution, I had to look in and outside of the classroom, here and other countries. I didn't grow up as someone who was particularly interested in environmental, economic, and social justice. I was a kid that just wanted to do math problems and science homework. But after allowing myself to explore and wrestle with the invaluable perspectives from my sustainability-rated classes, projects, research, and conferences at COP28, I had a change in mindset. In the heights of our pursuit of globalization, progress, and profit, I'm convinced that this world needs sustainable development more than ever. And if we keep teaching students like me to innovate without wrestling with the real challenge of what our neighbors and our planet have to endure to fuel our creativity, then we're holding ourselves back from even closing the gap between innovation and sustainability much faster. And in case you didn't know, we're already off track of meeting our 2030 sustainable development goals. And we can do something about this. One place of really high leverage in accelerating sustainable development lies in education. I'm particularly keen on undergraduate education, and I mean the core of it. The required classes, the syllabuses, the degree tracks, and most heavily weighted assignments, they have really high leverage. We can use core curriculums of multiple majors, including the most popular ones, to clearly and intentionally equip the next generation of future leaders and innovators with the skills, knowledge, and experiences needed to build a more just and sustainable world. By integrating sustainable development into the core of multiple curriculums, as we have done with like math, communication, natural sciences, and programming, we can have more hope that the next generation will be more equipped and eager to really take on real world challenges. Institutions like MIT, at the forefront of innovation, have a crucial role to play in this endeavor. They need to set the trend for sustainable development. Core curriculums at these institutions can better involve classes that help students to zoom out from their micro scales, the control volumes, their lines of code, and really see the big picture of what it takes to bring innovation to life in this globalized world, like the social, economic, and environmental dimensions of our creativity, and also the consequences that are so often out of sight, so out of mind. We can be better challenged to use our creative geniuses to address the broader and long-term impacts of our innovations. And as I mentioned earlier, there are classes at MIT that are already doing a phenomenal job in promoting sustainable development, but they need more support. They need more spotlight. They need to be better integrated into the core of our curriculums. I have them to thank as well for my change in mindset. It's time for more students to be leaving here with not just creative minds and hands, but with a mindset of responsibility towards our planet and those most vulnerable to the consequences of our pursuits. And it's not just enough to just act. We must, to just learn more about these problems and how to fix them. We must act. We must demand more from our institutions and ourselves to bring about a more sustainable and just world for all. And remember, this call is not about saving the planet. This is about putting back at the forefront of innovation what really matters to humanity. So let's not just build a brighter future for the most powerful or the privileged or my family or Jamaicans or people who look like me. But for all, regardless of where you're coming from, one love. Thank you.